إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. Greet you all with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. We continue with our subject which we had started last week, and this is the second lecture concerning the subject of al-fitan, temptation, trials, tests. And as we stated before, this is an issue that became very important for Muslims to learn about it, especially nowadays, because we see that the fitan is more than before, and that the access to fitan from the people and to the fitan and from the fitan to the people became more easier than before. As example to show you how serious the matter, that especially living in a place like in America, that most of the haram things is more convenience and more accessible to the people, Muslims and non-Muslims. To some places, doesn't matter if they are true Muslims or half and half Muslims, that means basically all what they know about from their deen, about their salah and things like this. But they have something, what you may call a moral code of life, or a code of moral life and respect and discipline and things like this. So if a person with he or she lower desire been attempted to do something unlawfully, Islamically, you understand, at least that the surrounding is going to stop him or her from doing such wrong thing, because the culture, because the people have something called haya, being shy and bashful and things like this. So sometimes the people are controlled by ethic, by code of respect, honor the older, listening to the parents, respecting neighbors and things like this. But when you come to a society, understand that the child could not even receive a discipline by his parents, because this is against the law, and I mean some kind of chastisement or a spanking. A teacher could not yell at him, a mother could not give him a spanking, as example. So now became much easier to lose our children in such a society, because they focus in so-called child right, but they did not see the child rights of discipline and the child rights of being a good citizen, okay? Basically, they want this child to get wild, okay? That the mother could not discipline him, the father could not tell him what's right, what's wrong, the teacher could not. So if you don't have anybody who's older in your life that can tell you no or stop or things like this, So yeah, we have people stay tell us to stop, but is not everybody going to stop because he tells them stop, okay? Some people, they will stop when he tells them stop, and people, other kids that you may have to tell them 10 times to stop, and they are not going to stop after 10 times. And if you use your hands, they understand, they know that their rights to call 911, okay? So in this a case like this, you concern about the rights of the child, but in the same time, you forgetting about the future of such a child that he has no anybody as an older person in his life, a person who can stop him, all right? Because a child is going to stay a child until he reach a certain age, okay? And it have to be some kind of a discipline in their life. You found the access of to internet and fast communication and things like this. So been invasion to Muslim countries and countries who are a distant or runs according a code of a discipline and culture, okay? For a woman to walk and walk in the street with no headpiece, as example, this is something shameful. But now when you come to a society that is okay for a woman to walk with a short in the street, okay? And now your pictures and your movies and your media carrying movies which is showing this is considered regular clothes, not even in the house, in the street. Now when you move and transfer the things to overseas or to Islamic country or Arab country or whatever you want to call it, and they are not exposed to this kind of culture because American people, you understand, took them a life, took them a time, took them, you understand, a lot of transition to reach, you understand, to be swallowing the things. Like as example about same sex marriage, you understand, 10 years or 15 years, we never heard about it, okay? But now we start to introduce it a little bit. So things, it takes time to be developed, right? So now it takes, you understand, American people, not all the American people, okay? But a part of the American people, it takes them a while, okay? It's a little bit, like you detest the medicine and we give you a drop, okay? And after this, they give you half a spoon, give you one spoon. So now you get used to the medicine, okay? So the same thing, you understand, the culture change here, it takes time. And people after this, to fight it, to make rights and make demonstration against it. But after a while, you understand, after some years, people going to, okay, at least I'm not going to do it, but I'm not going to be part of it in the same time, okay? I'm not going to be, okay, I could not be against it because now this is the law and you have to listen to the law, okay? But when you take you a while to be able to swallow or to acknowledge or at least to live, to accommodate, you understand, something called lesbians and gays and same marriage case, all kind of thing. Now, when you take this and transfer it over, you understand, live media and go to places like, you understand, in Pakistan or Egypt or in Africa, which you understand they are not exposed to these things, it will be like a shock. They call it a cultural shock or something like this, okay? So now became a very hard time for people to maintain their code of behavior and to stick to their culture or even to try to practice their deen, what they learned to be a deen. So we became in a time that is very serious, and this fitting, this trial, this temptation, these things which deprived people to stick to their belief or attempt, you understand, to turn the people away from Islam or to make you understand them a soft Muslim. They can swallow the wrong things or, okay, I'm not doing it, everybody's doing, but I'm not doing. But you acknowledge it and you pass by it, you did not even get irritated by hearing it or seeing it in the street. Why? Because now it became okay. You understand? Say, I'm not doing it, okay? But it's supposed to irritate you as a Muslim because it's against the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Now the temptation is going to soften your deen. What I mean by soften, make you not serious about your deen enough. All right? Or it's going to be in the way of the kafir to be a Muslim. All right? As a result of this, he found problems with people being Muslims, okay, and to be committed to the deen and to what Allah said, what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. As a result of this, he found some people now, they're giving them fatwa about the music and about women, you understand, walking with their pants, and as long as they have a scarf over their head, as if this is a hijab, and about, you understand, it's okay to do this, but you don't do it too much. And so the people now became, with all these things, is softening their deen. And when I say something soft, that means it's not hard. It's not that you're serious about it. It became like what you call, there is 100% orange juice. And there is a juice, you understand, that's been watered, been added to diluted, okay? So it still has the flavor of orange juice. You know, when you go to food line and buy 100% orange juice, this may be $2-3 for a half gallon. Okay, I don't go shopping, okay, I don't know about the prices. But when you get what you call lemonade drinks or orange juice drinks, is okay? Is not a real orange juice, but it still have what? The taste of?
Flavor.
Yeah, the flavor. Okay, you got the flavor. But it's not giving you the vitamin, it's not giving you, understand, the same thing. So this is what I mean, the people, the religion became soft. So the trials that happening nowadays is more than any other time. And more easy to catch with it, all right? And I hope people doesn't fall sleeping, you understand, would be more lenient, and because the more that you make the bed soft, is that you don't get up for your fajr to pray before sunrise, okay? And the more the things become convenient, people get. As a result of this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us, "For Allah, ma al-faqra akhsha alaykum." By Allah, is not poverty that I'm scared for you, all right? So when things become easy and money and toys and rubber bands, you understand, will people be disturbed, and toys, and all kind of things, people became like not serious about it. But sometimes poverty can be something as a medicine and a cure. Being having a hard floor, not, you understand, air conditioned there, people will be, you understand, fanning themselves while they're sitting, doing like this, okay? But the more he gives them air condition, like in Juma, as example, he found brothers against the back wall because it's relaxing. So now they're going to be what? More convenient. The more you get convenience, the more you understand you are not to be serious about this deen, because it's not costing you anything. I can be leaning, free class, you understand, a clean rug, everything is okay. You can give it a half an hour, but you can go and play and watch a TV for 3 hours. You don't, but you could not sit half an hour without playing with the rubber band, okay? 15 minutes, you could not. But if you go to football game, as example, or watching TV, you can stay for 3 hours. And if your brother or sister bother you, you may slap them, you understand? Say, she's bothering me, I could not even hear it. Okay, you want everything to be quiet. So you can watch, you can see. See, you understand? So now when you be more convenience that became more relaxing, and now we are not, you understand, taking it easy. Taking it easy means you understand you're going to start to falling asleep, you get, you understand, relaxing, you are not going to be paying attention to the lecture, you're going to play with your nice socks, okay, at least your socks, you understand, is about $12 a pair, but see what the imam is wearing. Okay, this is not the new fashion, by the way, but I don't have time to be baking socks, you understand? All that. So whatever, you put it on and keep walking, because I have something more important in my life. But when mom buys a socks for $12, you understand, can you imagine if she has 3 or 4 kids, as example? This is a whole month's payment, you understand? So this convenience life became part of the temptation, became part of the fitna, you understand? So now The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to the Sahaba, فوالله ما الفقر أخشى عليكم ولكن أخشى أن تبسط عليكم الدنيا فتنافسوها كما تنافسوها كما بسطت على الذين من قبلكم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم telling to the Sahaba, by Allah, it's not poverty that I'm scared for you. So what does this mean? That poverty sometimes can be a cure, a medicine, something good for you. All right? The more there is air conditioned, lights, comfortable, you're going to start lean and relax. And after this, the next thing, oh, class is over. Oh, it's over. I didn't. Okay. And you get up. Okay. Because the world behind you and mommy on their shoulders and you understand all these things relaxing. All right. So when you give them a rough chair to sit on it, all right, and you're going to have a notes, and you're going to have to pay, you understand, $50 per hour or semester, and you're going to, you understand, get a B+ or C+, now you worry about it. But when it tells you about your deen, which make you go to Jannah, or you go to hellfire, it's no big deal, all right? So the Prophet ﷺ said, it's not poverty that I'm scared for you. What I'm scared for you, that you get rich, that the dunya became open for you, flourish, okay? More cars, fancy cars. More, as example, look to telephones. What is a telephone? Telephone is a telephone. Basically, that you communicate. But now you understand, you want to understand, you have a phone and you have a connection, you understand, to Facebook, and you want to understand to be able to text, and you find now the telephone, before we used to pay $20 for it, you crazy? And people will be borrowing or getting an interest to buy a telephone for $500. And maybe understands you could not get a car from halal, they have to get it from interest, okay? Why? Because the luxury of the life. So this has became a temptation, the luxury expansion of the dunya, flourish of all this material thing, okay? So after this will be what? Will be running behind the dunya. This was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I'm not afraid about poverty. That means poverty can be what? Can be a cure for our problem. It make you reflect, make you think, okay? It makes you call on Allah. When the people in the end of prayer going to say, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, when they do this, when they have a nice ride, everything comfortable, when they're going to say this, when they're going to be, you understand, scared and, say, and start saying, oh God, oh, whatever they're going to call, okay? When? Anybody know? Have a good night, everybody. Anybody here? Can you understand English? Do you understand what I'm saying? When? When the people going to say, oh my God, oh my God.
What did you say?
Okay, good morning. Excuse me?
When they suffer.
When they suffering. When the car, when is the aeroplane start shaking? Why is it became bumpy ride, huh? And they think that they're going to die. And especially the captain start to say, make sure you have your seat belt in, you understand, and giving all this announcement. But as long as it's smooth, right? People drinking, people watching the movie in the airplane, people relaxing, people doing all kinds of things, okay? So sometimes poverty can be a cure and medicine for us. Because now you're going to say, oh Allah, please, I'm hungry. Oh Allah, please, I'm sick. So illness can be a means of making you can I borrow your rubber band? And the other one. Thank you. Okay, you can put them there. Pick them up after the class. Thank you. So people understand when they say they're going to call more in Allah. That means they're getting more closer to Allah. Same thing about poverty. Same thing if you haven't understand their president is somebody say, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to do this to you. Okay? It can be good for them. All right? Otherwise, they need somebody that will dance for them. And somebody understand, give them more and tell them yes. We're going to make the marijuana, same thing in California. We're going to bring it to South Carolina. Now became legally. This is what they're looking for, okay? And this is will be the good brethren. But when somebody telling them, okay, I'm getting you. Now they say, oh Allah, oh my God, help me. Oh my God, okay? Yeah. So the Prophet ﷺ said, I'm not scared of you for you to be poor. But I'm scared that you became rich. And the dunya became very accessible to you. And the material thing and will be compete towards getting this dunya. And is we're going to be what? Now we're going to forget about our deen. We're delaying our asr prayer. We don't have time, you understand, to attend Jum'ah. All the things, you understand, why the expansion of life. And this one of the fitness that we're talking about. So why is this session that coming today to be discussed? Because we have a lot of fitan, and we became more accessible to the fitan, and fitan have more access to us today than the people before us. People before us, you understand, we lived the times that we eat the leftover, all right? We lived a time that we did not have something called refrigerator, okay? We left a time, I'm talking about myself, okay? That the can of beans, after you empty it, you don't throw this can, all right? This will use it as a cup to drink with it, okay? I left the times that we don't have, you understand, the cold water. And if we want to have cold water, we have something made out of clay, okay? And you put the water and leave it, you understand, it will be little bit. Clay jar, okay? Mm-hmm. But now, we don't have, we're not talking about refrigerator, we're talking about, you understand, that ice maker in it, all kind of things, and there's some fancy things in, and we try to, every day we work hard so we can be able to buy this to such a degree that people even go and buy things, understand, with what? With interest. So this is became a fitna of the dunya. The fitna have different types and different ways. And today we became exposed really to the fitna, and the fitna became exposed to us. The Prophet ﷺ told us it's going to be so serious that a man, and when we say a man does not have to be a male, a man by the night, he is a believer. In the morning, he will be a disbeliever. That means a man or a woman? Or that in the woman or a man, in the morning, they are believer. By the evening, they will be what? Disbeliever. That means in a little time, it will be a completely total change in the person's behavior, in their deen. How this can happen? The Prophet ﷺ said, يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بَعَرَضٍ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا. That he will exchange his deen. He or she will sacrifice their deen because a portion, a little portion of this dunya. Okay? So it's not, you understand, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala depriving us from the halal and the good of this dunya, but when the halal or the dunya or the material thing became an obstacle in your way, to such a degree, you have a choice between you're going to make your salah or not to make salah. That you're going to be a Muslim or non-Muslim. Which one you're going to do first, okay? Which comes as a priority in your life, okay? As example, if you look to the Muslims in America, okay? Muslims of America, okay? You may find 90% of them, their children, they don't make Jum'ah for almost 9 months every year. This is reality, okay? Why? Because they go to school. They go to public school, okay? Although that they can get excused and to be excused to go to make Jum'ah. Because if he or she reaches the age of puberty, okay, and they abandon Jum'ah, and that the country giving you a religious excuse that you can go and do your service and you did not do it, so now became a serious problem. So if we raise our children from an early age in a mannerism that you have to be concerned about getting B and B plus, you understand, and you get your GED, and this is the main thing. Jum'ah, later on, okay? When you get big, you get your job, that means from the time 14 years old, all right, until you became 30 years old, when you finish all your schools and all the things, now, by your parents, you already been exempt from making Jum'ah. So now, this is destruction. That means we've been tempted. We made the school to be a trial, a fitna. So the school became our fitna. Became our fitna, our temptation, our test. So when a fitna comes to the Muslim, he's supposed to give his money first to avoid this fitna. Okay? If his money did not stop the fitna, and the fitna still coming towards him, he will give his life after this to save his deen. But never ever give your deen first to save your life or save your property. Because if you give your life or you give your money, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you what you lost for his sake. He may give you even more. You see? But if you give your money, you give your money for the fitna, you don't want to sacrifice this, and you would sacrifice your deen, the money will be taken away from you, your life will be taken away from you, and now you became a loser. You will be in a body of a human being, but a heart and mind of an animal, okay? You'll be like a horse, you'll be like a cow, because the Quran, it doesn't relate to your heart. It doesn't reflect, you understand, it doesn't get in touch with your mind. Why? Because you already exposed, when the fitna, you've been exposed to the fitna, you did what? You made a sacrifice. You said, no, I let my deen first go, and I'm not going to lose my job, or my wife, or my husband, or my children, or my degree, you understand, later. How do you guarantee you're going to live until you get your deen back? Okay? So this is something is very important that we need to study nowadays about the fitna due to the time and due to the place. Due to the time and the place. The more we get closer to the hereafter, the more fitna. And why? Because the merge of the nations and the fast communication and the people being distant from their deen, less knowledge. Before used to be more knowledge. Before it used to be more taqwa, more fear of Allah. More, even you understand, if it's not fear of Allah, out of respect, the people don't indulge in the haram. So now the deen became so thin. And now people became so more kufr. And being living also in America, this will be adding to Sumaya to the seriousness of studying this subject of the thing. So the fitna, when it comes, derive the people or take the people away, you understand, shift them from a sirat al-mustaqim. Can you imagine a train on a track? And some of these bad people, they go and remove all these screws and nuts and all the things, and okay? And when the train come, you understand, what's going to happen? The train and the people in the train, luggage, money, everything, okay? Now you're off track. So what is a fitna? A fitna will come. You are in a sirat al-mustaqim, you're making salah, you try to be a good Muslim, you try to do this, and something will come and will turn you to the other side. Little bit like this, and little bit like this. Next thing you find yourself what? Going the other direction. You are not in the track anymore, okay? This is what we're talking about, fitna. So the fitna is a trials. And the single of it called fitna, all right? We take them from the Sirat al-Mustaqim. One of them can be the shubha, the doubtful things, okay? That people will give them use weak hadith or fabricated hadith, or they did not have the proper knowledge about such a thing. Okay, as a result of this, the people are not practicing what is right. All right? Or otherwise, it can be the scholars themselves. They are not been taught the proper minhaj, or they became a slave of the dollar and the ruler, and they scare from the ruler, so they give fatwa according what is the president or the king wants them to say. Okay? So no, I rather, yeah, you understand, some of you heard about Muhammad Ali Klai? Anybody heard about this name before? Okay, one person is awake. I don't believe in this. Nobody know Muhammad Ali Klai, huh?
You just know Muhammad Ali.
Muhammad Ali? Not Muhammad Adli.
Ali.
Oh, Muhammad Ali. Mm-hmm. Okay? Muhammad Ali, you understand, was a boxer, champion, okay? He was the best man in the whole world for champion, okay, for boxing, is it?
Mm-hmm.
But guess what happened? When the war came, and he been ordered that he have to be part of it, been drafted, he refused.
Vietnam.
Yeah. In time of Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Okay? And after this, he been threatened that he be put in jail. Mm-hmm. What did he do? He went to jail. Okay? He chose to go to jail and not to go and kill innocent people for no reason. So this was a fitna for him. Okay? This was, so what he did, he rather not to go with this call and to do the right thing, even if it caused him to lose his freedom, will not going to be eating the same kind of food, not to be relaxing, not to be living in his house, not be with his family. So when the fitna come, we have to know. So some people, instead of saying, okay, I'm not a mufti anymore, I'm not a scholar anymore, I'm not going to teach anymore, okay, and I'm not giving the people the right, the wrong information. The people have the choice to do this, okay? You could not, you understand, be part of the fitna by making the halal haram to the people, and the haram is halal to the people, okay? All right. Also, the fitna can be in a matter of sickness and illness, that the person became so ill that could not fulfill his obligation or her obligation, all right? And the pain is so much that the person could not take it. Like a man, as example, was in the war with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the battlefield. And the Prophet, the Sahaba were admiring him so much. Okay? He was fighting, he was so brave, running back and forth and hitting the kuffar here and there. The Prophet and the Sahaba started to talk very highly about him. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, he is in hellfire. So everybody was shocked. Why is the Prophet saying this? Okay? Why he's going to go to hellfire? So one of the Sahaba is still what? Stop following him and spotting him any place. So the man got stabbed by one arrow. Okay? And it was so painful for him. Alright? And he didn't die. But the pain was so much for him to take it. So what did he do? He commit what?
Suicide.
Suicide. He bought like
a dagger,
okay, and he lay down in it to kill himself. Now the man came running to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam back, that he was watching him, say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Indeed, O Prophet of Allah, you are the messenger of Allah. So what happened? He's a Muslim, but why are you coming now to testify and to affirm it more? He said, what happened? He said, the man that he said he's from the people of fire, he did such and such. So sometimes the pain is so much, the illness. So it makes you, rahmukallah, it makes you, you understand, not patient with the qadr of Allah. So the illness itself can be what? Can be a fitna for you. It became a means of depriving you or dragging you or taking you away from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because a person who commits suicide, he will be in hellfire. All right? Yeah.
also a person, it maybe can be rich, and he lose all his property. Okay? Now he is not used to this kind of life. Now he have to go to welfare, or have to go, you understand, get some food stamps, or could not find a job, he could not take it. How I'm going, you understand, to be working $5-$10 an hour or whatever like this? He doesn't want this. He's embarrassed. So now he's going to go gambling, or he's going to understand. So now became the poverty became a fitna for him. All right? A person can be so rich. All right? And he may understand, I have a good example nowadays. So rich, filthy rich. And now, you understand, he feels that he can be the president. And he has the money. What he knows about, you understand, politics or this and that, doesn't know anything, but I'm rich, I have money, I make you money. So as long as I give you money, you understand, this it. Okay, I'm the president, okay? So the money became a temptation, okay? Became a driving the person away from Islam if he's a Muslim. Or stopping him from getting to Islam because the money make him not to think about Islam, even start to think, talk badly about Islam and Muslims. Okay? So now his wealth became what? A temptation for him, became a fitna for him. All right? So many things it can deprive the person from Islam, or it can make the person turn away from Islam, and both of them became a fitna. Sometimes also, the same thing can be a manha or a fitna. Okay? It can be manha or ni'mah. The same thing for one person with all illness, no jobs, no wife, everybody understand, forgot about him. It make him make a U-turn and come back to Allah. Repent. Stop all the haram that he was doing it. Things, hardship come to him, make him start to think and reflect. And somebody, he became so poor or so healthy, now he ready to punch everybody in their face and, you understand, take their property and do all kind of things. The same thing can be for somebody as a gift to bring him back to Allah. And can be a serious disaster and a fitna for the other person. Okay? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Quran, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالْخَيْرِ وَالشَّرِّ فِتْنَةً We shall test you with good and a bad as a what? A means of trials for you. So for one person can be a cause for him to come to Allah and repent, and another person can make him to get away from Islam. Therefore, we're saying that this issue of learning about the fitan is very important. We're going to talk about the fitnat al-mal, how the mal can be good, how the mal can be bad, how to deal when we have the money, and what to do when we don't have the money. We're going to talk about the fitna of the mal, the trial of wealth, trial of women, trial of some people, their trial is their mind, okay, their logic, common sense. Okay? So now they are not willing to listen to Allah. He said, but this doesn't make sense. So that means Allah is not Akbar to them. Okay? Their mind became what? The Ilah and the Deity. So whatever it makes sense to him or to her, this is what is right. Okay? Like nowadays, you understand, you see a lot of people, okay, they got a PhD degree, and now they study philosophy, and study all the things. So now the next thing, you understand, they start what? Doubting everything, even to doubting the existence of God that is there or not. He's not talking about God, you understand, Allah or Jesus or no, nothing called God, you understand, this is Mother Nature, and this it. Okay? This is also another fitna. The fitna of wars. Killing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling that it's going to be a time that the person will be killing his own people, in his own tribes, even his own cousin, his own neighbors. with no just cause. And we can see nowadays, you understand? Muslims, they understand. The Prophet said what? It's going to be fitanun taqta'a al-layl al-muslim. Okay? That is going to be a lot of trials and temptation like the darkness of the night that you could not see. You don't know what's right, what's wrong, what's halal, what's haram, what is bid'ah, what is sunnah. It will be a confusion. And you don't know which way to go. Exactly. Okay. Bazooka. Bazaar. Okay? So now it is very important that we learn about the fitna in advance. Why? Because when the fitna come, you said, yes, this is what I learned in the class. This is what the Prophet said in the hadith. And this is what happened, understand? Because one of the things, understand, we're living nowadays, as example, look, it's many things. It's fitna outside. All what you need to walk in the street. You can see it. Things that, you understand, will weaken your faith. Or make you what? Leave your faith. Especially if you love something more than what's supposed to be loved. Okay? Now, if this what you love, he or she or it or whatever it is, okay? Now, if this thing go left, you will go behind them left. If they go right, you go right. So you have to know in advance what to do when the fitna come. And don't think the fitna is one thing. There is a fitna. It's a plural. It's trials. Temptation. So you have to know about each one of them. And like we spoke last week, okay, and when we drink with the right hand, okay, that Dajjal, as example, the Antichrist. We have to know about it now, but when Antichrist come and stand in front of you and telling you, I'm Allah, what you going to do? Because you never taught, you never read about it, okay? So now, if you've been taught before, and you know, and you look at him, and you see it's written between his two eyes, what? Kafara. That he's kafir, he's a disbeliever. You see him with one eye. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, your Almighty Allah, he is not one eye. Okay? So the man is with one eye, and he's telling you, I'm God. He's not saying, I'm... No, he said, I am Allah. I am your Lord. And he will have something like paradise and hellfire with him. And he will do things beyond ability of a human being. Take one man and cut him two pieces. Can you imagine this? He will cut him two pieces. He will walk between the two pieces so you can see that he is dead. And after this, he will say to him, come back to life. He will come back to life. He said, you believe in me now? I am your God? What are you going to do? You see? So it's going to be a lot of temptation, a lot of trials, a lot of things will cause us that possibility that we lose our deen or that we be what? Confused in our deen. So if a person study and learn in advance, now he knows Surah Al-Kahf and he will read the first 10 verses, you understand this will be a protection for you from the Antichrist. Okay? So the same thing we want to know about the money, about the women, about the wars, about the ruler. If you have a ruler over you, you understand he's not ruling by Quran and Sunnah. Okay, what you're going to do? Should we make revolution against him or not? With the fitna of, you understand, being among the non-Muslim. There is many, 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 many fitna. This is a book, okay, that we're going to be studying. Okay, so you imagine how many type of fitna. It's very important that we keep with this class so we can learn in advance and we can know and we see how we do, how to deal with the fitna. Okay, if it's about money, how are we supposed to do with the money? Okay, and what is the money for? How are we supposed to handle it? And when we get into usury and when we don't get into usury. These things is very important to discuss. And I know, although that I know that you don't have a school tomorrow, okay, and most of you off tomorrow, And I see that some people already off. Okay. Is it? So we should drag the class a little bit more, but I see people start falling asleep. So I'm not going to make it longer than this, but I will appreciate that you try, you understand, to keep with the class, and for some reason you could not make it, that the next day you go to YouTube, you understand, and check my website, my link, so you can listen to continuing with this series of fitan. But it's always important that you sit in the class, because sitting in the mosque itself is a means of healing and rebuilding our iman. Okay? Like a battery in the car. Okay? You charge it. You refuel your car. So the same thing, understand? We can, yes, there's a lot of classes on the internet. But mosque is not in the internet. Okay? You need to be physically in the mosque, because you understand you are surrounded with the angels. The angels making dua for you. And this is part of what make our iman strong. Because if you don't have a strong iman, what's going to happen, amatullah, you're going to be falling into the fitna. You got it? Good. So, as for the nice good boys, inshallah, hopefully, that somebody will give you a ride to come tomorrow, so we can have a Quranic class. Inshallah. Inshallah, maybe you will try. Okay? You don't have a class at school tomorrow, is it? Oh, okay. This sounds good. So, inshallah, I'll be here from 2 to 5. You can come any time between this time. Inshallah, we can have a small class together. All right? If your mother is tired from you, she can dump you here. You understand? At 2 o'clock, I babysit you until 3 o'clock. All right? Subhanakallah wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka. Anybody have a question, comments, concern, correction? Don't ask Candy.
No.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so if my mama does drop me off here, will I have to go get my own food?
Is this your main worry?
Huh? Yes.
Okay, no problem. Don't worry about it. Well, yes, oh, sir. I forgot I'm fasting. Yeah, I will get you some food.
No, I can pay
for you. Oh, okay, your brother got to pay for you.
No, I don't trust you. Broke.
You broke? Okay. Inshallah, if you come for the sake of Allah, Allah will make a way for you that you eat. And don't be always worried about food. Be worried about you going to have some Islamic nourishment. You understand? But inshallah, Allah will make a way for us to have something to eat tomorrow. Don't worry about the food. Birds, Allah provide for them, and they don't even have a degree.
I try to make it.
Thank you.